are about to discuss is Ozymandias, okay, by P.B. Shelley. Okay, so who is P.B. Shelley? So you have read about William Blake, okay, you have read The Tiger, okay, or The Lamb, okay. So the primary thing about William Blake is that he was a romantic, okay. So who were the romantic? The poet who started to write, okay, poems on nature, not only nature but also human emotion, okay, and how human emotion, how we can relate human emotion to other objects, okay, that was the main motto of the romantics, okay. So Wordsworth was a romantic poet, we have Tintern Abbey, okay, Blake was one of the first ones, okay. Then we have P.B. Shelley, then we have Keats, then we have Coleridge also, okay. So all of them, they were romantics, okay. Now the poem we are gonna read today, okay, Ozymandias, is somewhat peculiar, okay. So Shelley, okay, mainly Shelley deals with myth, like Blake, okay, be it Greek, be it Roman, okay. But in Ozymandias, we will be seeing that P.B. Shelley actually was dealing with Egyptian mythology, not mythology, I will not use the term mythology, but Egyptian history, okay. And he actually using Egyptian history to connect his emotions, okay, to express his emotions, okay. So now, the name is Ozymandias, it's actually a Greek term, okay. Now I have written it down. The Ozy, it means in Greek air, and Mandias, the term Mandian is also Greek, and it came from the another Greek word, that's name is mandate, and mandate means to rule, okay. So from the title of the poem, you can easily understand that Shelley is talking about some ruler or a king, okay, then who is all powerful, almighty, okay. Now Ozymandias actually is the title of a Egyptian king named Ramses II. Ramses II was a pharaoh of Egypt. He was the son of Seti I, okay. He was the son of Seti I of the 9th dynasty, okay. Now so why Ramses II is famous, or why P.B. Shelley is actually used him to as the subject matter of his poem. Now see, there is a historical event behind this, okay. So you have to know about, just for your information, just to understand, there was an Italian traveler, okay, and his name was Giovanni Balzoni, okay. So Giovanni Balzoni was a archaeologist, okay. First he was a member of a circus, then later he became an archaeologist, okay. So this is a historical fact, and Giovanni was famous for many excavations in Egypt, okay. So Giovanni, in the city, Egyptian city of Luxor, near Gurna village, modern day Egypt, is Al-Karna, okay. In that Gurna village, he actually found a huge statue, okay, of a pharaoh. Now during that time, okay, Giovanni didn't know that the statue belonged to whom, which pharaoh, okay. But it was his idea, he knew that he had to bring out the statue from the ground, okay. So the statue was deeply buried within the sand, okay. Now with the help of some local people and the Egyptian government, Giovanni Balzani actually managed to pull the statue out, and the statue was sent to Britain, means London, okay. And during that time, when the statue actually arrived at London, okay, via ship, okay, so people came, okay, to see the statue. Okay, this, because the statue was actually huge, and Egypt was the land of mystery. Okay, to most of the people, of the Western people. Okay, so pharaohs, mummies, the statues, the temples. Okay, so they are all sources of mystery and gossip and mythology for the Western people. That's why they all came rushing to see the statue. Okay, Bibi Shelley was among those people. Okay, and after seeing the statue, Bibi Shelley actually wrote the poem Ozymandias. Okay, so this was the historical background behind writing the poem Ozymandias. Okay, now Ramses II was one of the very powerful pharaohs of Egypt. Okay, he is famous for his battle of Kadesh. The battle of Kadesh actually was fought between the Egyptian army and the Hittites. Okay, so Ramses II defeated them. Okay, it was a huge and terrible battle, and Ramses II won the battle. That's why he was very famous in Egyptian history. But not only that, Ramses II was a builder. Okay, means during his time in Egypt, there were numerous temples, numerous buildings were created. Okay, he is famous for those kind of structures. Okay, one of such important temple is the temple of Abu Simbel. Okay, I'm just writing the name, the temple of Abu Simbel. Okay, it was created during the time of Ramses II. Okay, so there is some controversy concerning the character of Ramses II. You have to understand that Ramses II was a very good ruler. Okay, but during his time, Egypt actually flourished. Okay, but at the same time, some historians say that Ramses II was actually really cruel ruler, cruel pharaoh. Okay, in some cases. Okay, there is no concrete evidence that proved that Ramses II was a cruel ruler, but in some cases we find some instances. Okay, he is actually suppressing the rebellions, he is using very violent means to suppress the rebellion during his reign. Okay, so this few evidence are there. Okay, that proved that Ramses II was a powerful yet cruel ruler. Okay, now he was good to his people to some extent. Okay, we cannot say that he actually troubled his people, okay, troubled his minions, but no. Okay, but to some extent we also can say that Ramses II did some nasty works during his reign. Okay, nasty works mean he was forcing, he actually forced the laborers who were actually building the temples or the other architectures. Okay, they were forced. Okay, and many times those people, they actually died. Okay, these kind of incidents were there, and it was not, we cannot say that Ramses II was the only one who actually forced the people to build the buildings and all. Many of other pharaohs in Egypt, they actually did the same. So we cannot blame Ramses II only. Okay, but it's a controversy. Okay, so Shelley is actually in the poem use that controversy. Okay, that see, the Ramses II was a powerful king. Okay, yet he was cruel. He actually built the temple, he actually built his statue to show the people, okay, or show the other kingdom, the kings of the other kingdom, they see, I am all powerful. This was the main motto of Ramses II, and this motto has been used by P.B. Shelley in his poem Ozymandias. Now I am going to read the poem. I meet a traveler from an antique land who say, see, so P.B. Shelley is actually saying that a traveler from ancient land, this ancient land is actually Egypt. So the traveler actually, he made the traveler, and the traveler gave him the account of the statue. To vast and trunkless legs of stone stand in the desert, near them on the sand. Okay, so he is actually talking about a huge statue. Okay, only the legs are there, the upper portion is actually broken, it's not there. Okay, half sunk, a shattered visage lies, whose frown and wrinkled lip and sneer of cold command tell that its sculptor well those passions read. Okay, so the legs, okay, and the other broken portion of the statue, they are actually buried in sand. Okay, because the statue is actually from the ancient time. Okay, naturally, the statue is actually standing. There is nothing around the statue. Okay, it's a desert. Okay, so sand is actually covering the statue. Okay, কারণ দেখো স্ট্যাচুটা তো অনেক দিন ধরে এমন একটা ডিসোলেট জায়গা কেন দেখা যাচ্ছে যে সি যে একটা এরকম স্থাপত্য এরকম একটা মাইটি স্ট্যাচু ইজ স্ট্যান্ডিং দেয়ার ইটস অ্যাকচুয়ালি ব্রোকেন ওকে চারিপাশে কিছু নেই শুধু আছে কি আছে অনলি স্যান্ডস ওকে এই সেটিংটা থেকে শেলি শুরু থেকে রিডারদেরকে বোঝাতে চাই যে ইজ ট্রাইং টু টেল দ্য রিডার দ্য সি সামথিং ম্যাগনিফিসেন্ট লাইক দ্যাট অ্যা স্ট্যাচু আর হিউজ স্ট্যাচু লাইক দ্যাট ইজ লাইং দেয়ার নোবডি ইজ লুকিং আফটার ইট okay so the statue is actually facing the curse of time mane somoy sathe sathe bali statue ta ke grohon korche mane bali statue ta ke aste aste crush kore nicche okay so nothing is there mane ekhane we can compare sand with time okay mane joto time aste aste egocche statue ta joto purono hocche bali ki kaaj korche bali aste aste statue ta ke গ্রাস করে নিচ্ছে ওকে সেই স্ট্যাচু আমি আগেই বলেছি যে আই হ্যাভ অলরেডি টোল্ড ইউ দ্য স্ট্যাচু ওয়াজ মেন্ট ফর টু সি টু পোর্ট্রে দ্য গ্লোরি অফ দ্য কিং রামসেস দ্য সেকেন্ড অর ওজিম্যান্ডিয়াস ওকে সো নাও দ্য স্ট্যাচু ইজ অ্যাকচুয়ালি ব্রোকেন অ্যান্ড দেয়ার ইজ স্যান্ড ওকে দ্য স্যান্ড ইজ অ্যাকচুয়ালি কভারিং দ্য স্ট্যাচু ডে বাই ডে ওকে So it means what? The glory is being taken over by time. The glory of the king Ozymandias is being taken over by time itself. Now see. Hapsung, a shattered visage lies, whose frown and wrinkled lip and sneer of cold command tell that his sculpture will those passions read. Okay, so the sculptor or the artist who created the statue, he actually caught the cold sneer of the king. মানে হচ্ছে Ozymandias যে একটা পাওয়ারফুল তার যে অন্যদের প্রতি একটা অবজ্ঞা ছিল যে আমি অল পাওয়ারফুল আই এম দ্য কিং অফ দ্য কিংস এই যে একটা অ্যাটিটিউড গর্ব এটা তার মুখের এক্সপ্রেশন দেখেই বোঝা যেত এবার আর্টিস্ট কী করেছে সেই মুখের এক্সপ্রেশনটাকে নিখুঁতভাবে ওই স্ট্যাচুর মধ্যে তুলে ধরেছে ওকে কিন্তু তারপর দেখো কী বলছে হুইচ ইট সার্ভাইভ স্ট্যাম্পড অন দিস লাইফলেস থিংস দ্য হ্যান্ড দ্যাট মকড দেম অ্যান্ড দ্য হার্ট দ্যাট ফেড ওকে বলছে যে ওই যদিও বা স্ট্যাচুটা ভেঙে গেছে ওকে পা আলাদা ট্রাঙ্ক আলাদা ভেঙে ভেঙে চারিদিকে ছড়িয়ে আছে কিন্তু মুখের মধ্যে যে স্নিয়ারিং এক্সপ্রেশনটা আছে যে গর্ব আছে অন্যকে অবজ্ঞা করার যে প্রতিফলনটা আছে ইট স্টিল এক্সিস্ট ইন দ্য স্ট্যাচু বাট ইট ইজ টোটালি ব্রোকেন হুইচ ইট সার্ভাইভ স্ট্যাম্প অন দোজ লাইফলেস থিংস দ্য হ্যান্ড দ্যাট মক দেম অ্যান্ড দ্য হার্ট দ্যাট feed. Okay, means this is a very interesting line. Okay, now Shelley is talking about what the ancient traveler is talking about the mentality of the artist. When the artist was creating the statue, okay, what was his mentality? So I told you that in some cases there is evidence that Ramses the second actually forced the people, okay, to build the temples, okay, the labors, okay, so they were forced and they died actually. So the artist was also forced, okay, so the artist, he is creating the statue, but he is not willing to create the statue, okay, he is just forced by the king, otherwise he will be dead, the artist will be dead by the order of the king, okay. That hand that mocked them and the heart that fail okay but he was actually creating the statue for with his all these passions okay কারণ যদি নিজে passion দিয়ে স্ট্যাচুটাকে তৈরি না করে তাহলে কিন্তু স্ট্যাচুটা যে মানে মুখে যে Ozymandias-এর বা Ramses the second-এর মুখে যে গর্বভাব ছিল সেটাকে ফুটিয়ে তোলা সম্ভব ছিল না হাতটা হয়তো মক করছিল ওকে যে Ozymandias আমি তো এরকম তোমার স্ট্যাচু তৈরি করতে থাকছি কিন্তু স্ট্যাচু কিন্তু ইমমর্টাল হবে না ওকে ইভেন দ্য আর্টিস্ট নিউ ওকে দে ইটস জাস্ট আ ফিজিক্যাল অবজেক্ট ওকে দ্য টাইম উইল ইভেন্চুয়ালি ডিস্ট্রয় ইট ওকে সো হ্যান্ড ওয়াজ মকিং বাট হিজ প্যাশন ওয়াজ উইথ হিজ ওয়ার্ড ওকে So there is a contradictory notion. So this line is very important. And this line is actually this line represents the attitude of the artist or the sculptor when he was building the statue. And on the pedestal, these words appear: "My name is Ozymandias, King of Kings. Look on my works, ye mighty, and despair. My name is Ozymandias, King of Kings. Look on my works, ye mighty, and despair." So this was written, okay, in the statue. Okay, there is a place in the statue. These inscriptions were there, and in the inscription, Ramses II has said, "See, I am Ozymandias. I am the King of the Kings." The statue is represent, or the statue represent Ozymandias' pride. Okay, so it is natural for any king. Okay, if you read history, you will see the kings were creating numerous buildings, statues, inscriptions, whatever. Okay, to prove their glory and power. Okay, so in case of Ozymandias, it was also same. Okay, "Nothing besides remains from the decay of the colossal wreck, boundless and bare. The lone and level sands stretch far away." The last three line is very important. Okay, now Shelley is actually summarizing his whole idea. Okay, the main object of his poem. See, Shelley is a romantic. Okay, so this glory, not glory, but pride. Okay, the emotions of pride, the emotion of to objectify other people, subjectify. Okay, means ami sob jani, this kind of attitude. Okay, the romantics hated this kinds of attitude. Okay, so romantics thought mainly that there is a supernatural force working. Okay, a divine power. Okay, the divine power is actually controlling us. Okay, so not only Shelley, be it Keats, be it Coleridge, be it Wordsworth. In case of Wordsworth, the divine power was nature. In case of Shelley, it was God. We can say God or any other supernatural power. Okay, in case of Blake, it was God. Okay, so Shelley and Blake and Coleridge, we can say the concept of this divine entity. Whatever you are creating, okay, to prove your glory, okay, this is a physical object, and the physical object is always decay. Now that physical object or the statue of Ozymandias represents his power, represents his pride. Okay, so Ozymandias ki bhabe chilo lokin statue ta thakbe loke amar kotha bhabe ei statue ta dekhe loke bhoy pabe. Okay, kintu ekhon ki hoyeche statue ta to bhenge geche charidike shudhu bali. Okay, nothing remains. Okay, bali gulo modhe ja balir modhe statue gulo edar odar bhenge bhenge tukro gulo chhoriye ache. So where is the glory? Shelley bolche je Ozymandias was trying to prove his glory jate si immortal thakte pare physical tar body mara jabe kintu le lok jana tar statue dekhei mone kore that this was Ozymandias, this was Ramses the second. Okay, but ultimately seta ki hocche? No, Shelley bolche see, we are all puppet to some. We are all puppet and some divine or supernatural power is controlling us. So Ozymandias, when you are actually boasting a lot, okay, that this statue, people will see this statue, the kings, other kings will see this statue and they will fear me. Okay, this idea is very wrong. Okay, because everything will decay. It is the law of nature. Some superpower, some divine power is working. Okay, and that divine power will decide who will be immortal and who will be remember forever by the people, and who is a forgettable character. Okay, and history will forget that person. Okay, so Shelley, again ami last line ta bolchi, Shelley is continually indicating that nothing remains forever. Human pride, human vanity, those things will be eventually destroyed. So this is the main theme of Ozymandias.